Anyway, I'm Marcia Wensang, BenQ Brand Ambassador, and I'm here with Bert Monroy, another fellow brand ambassador, digital fine artist. I've known of Bert for 20 years, and last year at Adobe Max, I found out that Bert is also a BenQ Brand Ambassador. And I got a chance to meet Bert, and he's been one of the best experiences ever. He is the nicest person I ever met, really down to earth, and he's also generous enough to give me some time today to ask him some of the questions. Bert, thank you so much.
Hey, it's a pleasure.
Being with me.
It's fun to be here.
So, I'd like to ask you a few questions, starting off with, like, how have you, you know, briefly, how have you got into digital illustration, digital painting? Because what you're doing right now are just mind-boggling. If you, you know, the work that you do is just spectacular.
Well, thank you. I've been an artist my entire life. In fact, my mother gave me, recently before she died, she gave me my first recognizable drawing. I was 2 years old. But you can tell what it was that I was drawing. And she gave it to me. And I've been drawing my entire life because it was a way of survival for me from where I came from and everything else. I was always drawing, just always drawing to keep myself alive and occupied. It was when I was in school, I was looking for a high school, and the Sister St. Helen, I remember my teacher, she said, "You've been in trouble for drawing in class all these years. You should try to get into the High School of Art and Design," which I did. I got in, I took the test, I got in, and that was my first, the beginnings of my formal training. I went into the military after that, and then when I came out, I went to the School of Visual Arts and took some classes, where I later on became a teacher there. But that was my formal training, so I've been drawing my entire life. My business end of it, I became an art director and creative director at various ad agencies back in the 70s and stuff. So that's what I did commercially, and I did a lot of commercial illustrations. But painting, I was always into it. Now, in 1984, I had a small ad agency that I had in New York, and my partner said that we had to computerize. So I said, you know, fine, go ahead, get your computer. But I went down to the store to look at this thing, and this little Mac 128. I sat there, and I drew a box, and that's cool. And I moved it, and I said, wow, you know, this is going to save me a lot of tracing paper and working up my layouts, you know?
Right.
And then I did something that I thought I broke it. So I called the clerk over. I said, "I think I broke this thing." He said, "Oh, no, you're in fat bits." And I, "Fat bits?" He says, "Yes, you've zoomed into the pixel level." And then he put me back, and I said, so I could draw that deep in, and that clicked.
I said,
"This is it. This is the future." I was in that store every day until my machine got delivered. They let me play because I was selling machines. I had mastered Mac paint after about 2 days, and they let me sit there. And people would come over, and I said, "Oh yeah, look what it does!" And so I was selling machines
for
them. And then when my machine came, that was it. I gave up the ad agency, and I started a whole business in '84 around the Mac. Because that summer, I put out this thing called Human Forms that let you build human bodies anatomically correct by different body parts that you would connect and so on. And then I just built the whole business around it. And then, you know, since I took it so seriously and I started doing so many things, I started getting published in Mac World and all these places, that anybody who's working on some kind of software, since there were very few of us who were known, I would get to see things, which is why I got to see Photoshop years before it came out. And also my partner, the guy who co-wrote the Photoshop, the first book, David Biedney, with me, he was a technical editor at Mac User, so he used to get a lot of stuff early too. So I got to see stuff really early, which helped me to develop a lot of the tools, because they would say, how can I make it better, how can I improve the UI, and the same thing happened with Photoshop. I saw it early, and then through the years, I've helped develop a lot of the parts of it, especially like the brush engine and things like that. So I've always been a part of the business because these are my tools, and I get really excited about them. And if I have the opportunity to make them better, I'm in there. But the painting part, I've my whole life. It's just that now I'm digital, and I've been digital since '84.
Awesome, really cool. So can you share with us some of a glimpse of the current work that you're working on, things that excite you right now?
Yeah, well, I got these BenQ monitors. This is my workstation here. These two BenQs are 32-inch BenQs like this one. And this is a 32-inch Wacom, which BenQ makes the monitor for that too.
Oh, that's awesome.
This is a Cintiq, and that's a Cintiq companion. That holds the panels. This is where I work, and the BenQs is where I view things.
Oh, okay.
Now, when I suddenly had two of these guys side by side, I got inspired to do another panorama. Because I did Times Square, which took 4 years, and it's 25 feet
right.
wide. But now with the new Mac and stuff, I decided I can up the resolution and get
right.
more detail, and I decided to do another panorama. So this will be my third panorama, which I hope to unveil next year for the 30th anniversary of Photoshop. So
that's awesome.
It's an exciting time, especially with those monitors, because it's so clear.
I know.
The color is so precise that it really allows me to visualize what I'm trying to do and get it right. I also print just to be sure.
Oh no, for sure, definitely.
But it's always between what I'm creating, what I'm seeing, what I'm printing, they're all the same. So
gotcha.
It works really well.
So here's an interesting thing. So we kind of found out how BenQ fit in your workflow a little bit. I use BenQ all the time, so I kind of swear by their monitors. They're really great. But how have switching from any other display you used before to BenQ improved your productivity? I know BenQ is the inspiration for your latest artwork that you're going to unveil next year, and I'm looking forward to it.
Well, I'll tell you, it's the clarity
okay.
and the color, how accurate the color is. I had an Apple monitor,
mm-hmm.
that old big thing they had.
Yes.
And it was okay, but mm-hmm. it wasn't as clear as I would like it, but it gave me a big feel to look at. But then it started messing up. I'd get these little blue hazes on
right.
things every
uh-huh.
now and then. It wasn't consistent. It would just go on and off and stuff. And then in the house, I would sometimes take my laptop and use the TV.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have a 4K TV, so I would use
right.
the TV. I thought, you know, maybe I'll get one of those TV for my computer. I did. It wasn't working. It just didn't look good. And then BenQ approached me with this the monitor, and I took it out of the box. I set it up, and boom, it worked right away. And that was it. I was just blown away. I said, "This is it. This is the viewing monitor." And then when I got the second one, the first thing I did is I took my Times Square piece, which is 25
right.
feet, and I put it across the two.
Uh-huh.
And I said, "I got to do a new panorama that'll fit perfectly within the two monitors." And that was the inspiration to do that.
That's
so
awesome.
That's what I'm working on now, is something that goes perfectly across the two monitors and fills it up. So it's fun. And it helps because you can see here, like what I'm doing is I'm working down here,
mm-hmm.
panels are here, and then these are all my reference material.
Right.
Now behind these, so they're not shown here, behind it here is a closer view of what I'm working on, and back here is a full view of the whole image. So that way, at any point, I could just switch to which window I'm looking at,
mm-hmm.
and I would see what this looks like. Because I'm getting better color, even though this is also a BenQ monitor, it does have a film for the
right,
touch
exactly.
sensitivity. It doesn't give me the brilliance and stuff that I get from the BenQs on top.
Gotcha.
So I will switch up there to see the effect of what's happening, and then I switch back to get back to work, and I'll look at the reference up there. But that's when people come to my studio too, I get a lot of visitors to the studio, and when I want to do a presentation, I used to project onto something. Now, the ratio for seeing
right.
this, you know, stand on the side and get accurate
right.
color. So I just then I'll mirror all three of them, so that way they see what I'm doing up there, and that's now how people see everything on the BenQs rather than projecting it onto a screen. I use the BenQs as my display monitors, so anybody comes to my studio, that's what they're seeing on those. Because they're clearer, the color is better, and it's that clarity that's the most important thing.
Right.
My stuff is so detailed that to see it on those monitors, I really get the feel of what I want, you know? And when I'm displaying it to people, they can see the sharpness of what I'm creating.
That's awesome. Yeah, it's just amazing experience using BenQ. Now, the other thing too, there's a piece of work that you have done that you showed me that is on your website, is the Amsterdam one, right? That
yes.
If you go onto his website and you view the Amsterdam picture, if you start to zoom in, you will see that the cloud layers are starting to go away as if you're walking through the scene.
Yeah.
That is just fantastic. But to really appreciate Bert's work, you have to look at it, but also not the whole picture, but zoom into the little details.
Well, that's a funny story. Like Times Square, it's been on,
right.
it's in the Computer History Museum, and the same thing, I can show you pictures. That, you know, he's this 25-foot canvas,
right?
And so, you can stand back and see this thing, but people are like this.
Yep.
They're just in there trying to see that detail, you know? The cool thing about, you know, if you get a print, it looks great, but most of the stuff, like the Amsterdam one,
mm-hmm.
I tell people the best place to see the Amsterdam is online.
Ah,
because
okay.
it's developed so that there's 11 layers of fog, so the closer you get in, the layers start to disappear.
Right.
So when you're way into the paint, all the fog is gone. So you can now pan around and see everything really clearly. As you start to pull back, the fog starts coming in. So when you're way back, all the fog comes back.
Right.
So that's when it has to be seen online, because you can't do that with the print.
Absolutely.
You know? And Times Square, which is a gigantic thing, when you see it online, you can zoom into the eyes
exactly.
of the people in the foreground and see right. the reflections of what they're looking at. And you start to understand why it took 4 years to do it. But it's that kind of detail that people look for.
Right.
They expect it, you know,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not doing it because they expect it. I do it because I want to do it. Because
right.
that gives the, no matter what level you're looking at it, you're there. So you can get real close to something and see that little bit of dirt or that little hair that's hanging on the brush or whatever. I like to put all that detail in because it gives life to the thing. That's why I'm not a photorealist, because they adhere to the photograph.
Right.
So there's a depth of field and all that distortion, whereas I don't. Mine is more like being there. So wherever you look, whether it's real close or, you know, 2 miles down, it's all going to be clear. So wherever your eye goes, it's in focus. So I try to create things that are a little more realistic.
It's also fascinating too, talking to you and watching your demos and finding out the amount of research you put into your work to figure out the reflections and everything. It's just mind-boggling every time. I mean, even just at this Adobe Max here, when you were just showing me some of your other works, and when you zoom into the details of it, I'm still mind-blown by the whole thing.
Yeah, some people say, you're really anal, you know, stuff like when they see the amount of effort that goes into the research, and where I build models and just to study angles and stuff like that. But it's important for me to get that realism. I can't just rely on the photograph.
Right.
And it's something, well, like the Amsterdam. I was inspired when I started going through my shots of the trip, and I couldn't just go back to Amsterdam and shoot more shots. I relied on Google Street View.
Right.
So I walked up and down to see,
yes.
get closer on a door mm-hmm. so I could see what a doorknob looks like. Because then when I recreate it, I want right. to be able to get that clarity. And so it does require a tremendous amount of research, days, sometimes weeks of research. And then, like the new piece, there's been a lot of photo studies that I've done mm-hmm. and a tremendous amount of research online. Google Street View, looking at how buildings, what their windows look like, and
mm-hmm.
then just doing a Google search on a particular address, see that building, see how everything,
awesome.
What's the roof look like, you know. So I rely on that.
Your work's mind-blowing. I appreciate looking at it. I appreciate meeting you. Anything else you'd like to add before we wrap this up?
Yeah, the thing I like that most usually is that I do all the stuff, I do it for myself.
Mm-hmm.
And in the process, I'm learning. I'm learning some new technique. And that's, every painting has to have a challenge.
Right.
Know? So that way, if I don't learn anything, there are a few that I just did because I wanted to waste some time.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And those are the ones that are very simple and all that. But I'm learning along the way, and what I really get out of it after that, if they buy my prints, it doesn't matter. It's teaching them what I've learned along the way and hoping that I'll inspire somebody else, not to get as crazy as I do. You know, like people say, I can't do mm-hmm. you know what you do. And I tell them, you have to do what I do. Do what you do, you know.
It's, right.
I, what I'm trying to do is to inspire people to find their own creative self and to take the time to explore, not be afraid of the machine.
Mm-hmm.
Push the buttons to see what they do.
Right.
Hold down the option button and push the button
right.
to see what they do. So experimentation, that's part of the fun. I tell
right.
them it's to approach things like Photoshop like a video game. Instead of killing somebody or blowing something up, you're creating something, you know.
True.
It might be an explosion, but
right.
but you're creating something. And what I like to do is to inspire people to find their own creativity. And that's what I hope that they get out of my paintings. They see what I've done and they say, well, I like to try something. Maybe
right.
not that crazy, but I like to try something. So that's what I want to, more than anything, is to have people get into their own psyche, get into their own souls and find their creativity and not to be afraid to pursue it. Like I said something in another interview, which I was like, hey, great idea. I told people that never, because I've had people say, I can't do that, you know. Never say I can't do that. If you want it bad enough and you work at it, you'll be able to do it. So don't hinder yourself by automatically limiting your ability to do something. Make that a challenge so that you want to get out there and work at it and perfect that technique and learn that software. You know, in the long run, in the end, you're not losing anything, but you've gained a lot of knowledge and right. that satisfaction that you were able to create something.
Yes.
And that's what I want people to never limit themselves by thinking they can't do it. Try it.
Awesome.
Take that step and push yourself to the limits, and that's the way to get ahead.
Well, you definitely inspired me for the past 3 years, and I'm still looking cool. forward to your work every day. I check your website every so often. But Bert, thank you so much for your time
today.
Been
a pleasure,
I really appreciate it.
And it's great to hang out with you.
Yeah, absolutely.
See you guys.